Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. Let's pull back together. So one thing I want to add on the sexual abuse piece before we move on to some of the other stuff we're going to talk about. Sexual abuse in the church, whether reported or underreported, has a whole nother dimension of pain and issues around it. Because I have now been abused by someone in authority over me, in my spiritual authority over me, that is supposed to protect and care for me, and they betray me. Same thing is true when a father sexually abuses a child, kind of similar. It doesn't have the spiritual dimension as much, but that is someone whose job it is, we all know, parents protect children, they don't harm them. So but the betrayal bond is really, really deep in that place. The other thing I would say in how we as churches respond is we need to make sure that the victim is never victimized again. And we don't mean to, but we can do it really easily. What were you wearing that day? Right? What is that question implying? It's your fault. You somehow are responsible for that other person's behavior because of what you were wearing. And I'm sorry, I should dress modestly. That is true. But I actually am not responsible for someone else's behavior and choices. They are. No matter what I have on or don't have on, I'm never responsible. They are. Particularly if it's a power exchange difference. If it's an adult and a teenager, huge, huge. You've got an adult using their power. And then you add the dimension of the power and authority of the church over it. Huge betrayal. So we as a church need to be very mindful, and we need to make sure we don't re-victimize a victim. That we treat them with care. We treat them with concern. We treat them with understanding. One of the biggest things I forget, and I am terrible at this, so I'm a touchy person. I give hugs. That's just who I am. We should always ask permission before we touch another person because we don't know their story. If someone's been traumatized and I then try to touch them, and particularly if I'm a pastor and they've been traumatized by a pastor, are you kidding me? I need to make sure I am very mindful that I don't know this other person's story. And I may not know if there's been abuse in that story or not. So I just think as a church, we need to make sure that we are aware, mindful. I encourage people to get counseling, right? Whether they report or don't report. I honestly think reporting is always the route to go for a couple of reasons. You think about fight, flee, or freeze. At least if I report, I'm fighting. I'm getting out of the stuck place of freezing. I'm having my voice put back in. So I do try to encourage people to report. But even if they don't, I'll encourage them for counseling. They can't work on this alone by themselves. They need someone to help them navigate through. And they need a close community that won't judge. That won't judge any behaviors around that. So just wanted to touch back on that for a minute. So we're going to go into talking about some issues around homosexuality, around transgender, just some issues around things that our world and our society is becoming very normalized around, and how we as a church perhaps can frame that, look at that, and respond to that. But I think this is from, I don't know if you're aware with Mark Yarhouse. He's written quite a few books. What's the Christian, Homosexuality and the Christian, Gender Identity, Understanding Gender Identity. He wrote on gender dysphoria. So he's a psychologist, he's a Christian, and he has been working in this arena for many years. He's at a Regent, and he is very good. His work is good. I was listening to a webinar that he put on recently about pastoral care of the LGBT community. And he basically said the different views and approaches to things like transgender, that I just really thought, this really resonated with me. So we can have an integrity view, which is a view about that really stresses the sacredness of male and female and the differences, the sacredness of the Genesis story. And that can be where sort of the weight of our foot lies, is on that integrity place and view. Or we can have a disability view. Now, I don't like this word. If I were him, not that I am Mark, but if I were Mark, I'd have chosen another word than disability. But this view is all about you have a perspective of sexual orientation and identity and the fallen world, that the fall has impacted us, right? So it's about the impact of the fall view. And then there's a diversity view, which is kind of the LGBT community's view. And that is an embracing view. To be celebrated, differences are to be celebrated, they're to be expressed, right? They're not to be have any judgment around them. More, all is welcome. All is okay. Now, the problem we run into is if somebody with an integrity view is talking to somebody with a diversity view, they are coming from opposite poles trying to have a conversation. Right? So it's really helpful when we're talking about this is we kind of understand who am I talking to and where are they coming from on this? Right? Because I need to know how closely we're aligned or how far apart we are on this as we're having this conversation. So I just think your house gives us a pretty good sort of frame to think through that a bit. This is the age-old question. Is it nature versus nurture? What causes sexual differences and issues? Is it nature? Is it nurture? Does nature cause homosexuality, or is it the family? Is it nurture? Is it their story? What causes it? Right? And I kind of, your house kind of goes with the attitude of, he's not really sure this is really an important question. So, and he will say, he works with people, and he'll say, what would it mean to you to know the answer to that question? How would that help you? If you knew the answer to this question, how would it help you? Because honestly, we don't know. Yes? How's that? How's that for an answer? Yes. Is it nature versus nurture? Yes. We live in the fall. Because, and I know that sounds cliche, but it's true. And us in the Christian community, we just want to know the cause. Because if we know the cause, we can fix it. If I know what's causing homosexuality, we can make sure our people don't do that anymore and we can fix it. If I know what's causing the cause of transgender issues, we can just fix it if we know what causes it. And actually, honestly, I feel like God clearly says to us, or to me, is, Carolyn, if I gave you that, you wouldn't need me. You wouldn't need me. You just fix it. I wouldn't be in the middle of any of this. I was once taking a theology class with a professor named Richard Pratt, and I will never forget his comment on this, but he said, you know, if God made scripture like a recipe book, we really wouldn't need God anymore. We wouldn't need to have to wrestle anymore. We could just go to our recipe book and see what the ingredients are that we need. And we really wouldn't see our dependence on him. I think that's true. So nature versus nurture. I think there are some that nurture has a heavier weight foot in what's going on with them than nature. And I think for some, nature has a heavier weight foot than nurture. But I don't think we can ever separate these two and say clearly one or the other. I have asked my son repeatedly, were you ever abused? You went to Boy Scout camp. Were you ever abused? Did anyone do anything ever inappropriately? And he goes, Mom, not that I know of. Not that I remember. I don't remember anything. My husband racked his brain over what he had done as a dad. Right? Because all the scripture says is you're an absentee dad. Right? That's what causes guys to be gay. Dad's busy, he's working, he's playing golf, he's never home. That's just not our story. My husband runs his own business. He's home. We did family vacations all the time. I mean, our kids had both of us. No, that doesn't seem to ring true. Now, were we perfect parents? Trust me, we did a lot of mistakes. We continue to. But no, all the things that give us causes don't ring true to us or our friends. When our friends found out our son was gay, our friends were like, really? Him? He's the last person I would have suspected. He's big, he's burly, he doesn't fit a stereotype at all. I was with my daughter the other one time, and we were, my kids both live in New York City, and we were riding the subway. That's just insight into how weird our family is. We're riding the subway, and my son has himself and a couple of his friends with us, and they're all gay, and my daughter and I and my sister is with us. And we're on the subway, and the guys are carrying our bags, and they're all being very polite, and they're big, huge guys, and they're all gay, right? And my daughter says, I've never been around so many big, hunky, gay men in all my life. True. True. We have to be careful of stereotypes. So we're going to discuss homosexuality. We're going to discuss transgender. We're going to hit on sexual addiction. I'm going to talk a little bit about sexual fetishism, and then sexual offenders a little bit. That's kind of the direction I hope for us to, it's a lot to cover today, so we're going to go pretty quick. So I already said homosexuality causes, doesn't seem the right question. We don't know. We honestly don't know. Right? And anyone who tells you they do, I kind of take the whole view. You guys might, hopefully you won't stone me for this. I kind of take the same view as when people tell me they understand the Trinity. Right? That they get the Trinity fully. I'm like, really? Because I believe it, but I don't get it. I don't understand it. Right? But I believe it. Same thing with homosexuality. We know what Scripture says. As I said, I searched desperately, said, Scripture, please, please, please tell me it's okay. Tell me my son is not in sin in this place. I didn't see it. It's not there. Scripture, definitely. Leviticus 18:26, men should not lie with men as they lie with women. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 12, that whole list of sins that we are not to be anymore since we are new creations, homosexuals, is there. And then 1 Timothy 1:10 are some particular ones. But Scripture clearly does not say it's okay. So gay identity. So there's a way, I believe, and this is truly in sort of my readings and sort of what I've come to understand and believe, is I believe I can have same-sex attraction and not have gay identity. I believe that is true. I can't change if I have same-sex attraction. As I said, we talked before, I don't know why I'm attracted to my husband and I wasn't attracted to that lovely man that wanted to just thought out the world rose and set on me. I don't know why. Same thing is true, I think, with same-sex attraction. My son will say to me, Mom, I didn't choose this. People who say it's a choice, that is an offensive thing to say to someone. You chose this. Just don't choose it. We don't choose our attractions. I don't see any way we do that. I could not make myself be attracted to that man that wanted to spend his rest of his life with me and buy me things and take me out to nice dinners. As much as I would, that would have been lovely, but I could not make myself attracted to him. I couldn't have, right? And so it's offensive to say, just make a different choice, right? But there is a process of choosing a gay identity. And this is also from Your House. But Your House says, we come to a place where we recognize we have attraction. It's usually around middle school. For individuals, around middle school, they realize, I'm not attracted to the opposite sex. I'm sexually attracted to the same sex. So then there's a wrestling, particularly if it's a believing middle schooler. So there's an understanding of attraction. Then there becomes more of an orientation, which is more of an accepting place. There's less struggle, right? This whole homosexual piece, this whole identity piece, the orientation phase is I'm becoming more and more oriented toward this becoming my identity. I am gay. And an identity is a function of who my, it's a, that idea of my interbeing, my interworth, who I am. You know, I will say to my son, you know, it's interesting to me, maybe my heterosexuality is a part of my identity and I don't realize it, but I don't really think much about it. I don't know about you guys, if you're heterosexual, do you think about your heterosexuality being a part of your identity? But I suspect it is more of my identity than I realize. Because it's normed, we don't have to think about it. it's what the norm is. But I suspect it is very much a part of my identity as Carolyn Sinclair, that I am heterosexual. I think that feels true. What your house will say, particularly in working with youth, is allowing youth up here to express, talk about, sort of help them have believers that will come alongside of them when they're wrestling with attraction and orientation before they ever claim identity. Because he will say, our identity is to be in Christ. Our identity is not to be in our sexuality and our sexual attraction. Our identity is to be in Christ alone. So if I'm a follower of Christ, what does Christ tell me about my sexuality? But first and foremost, I'm a follower of Christ. And then that informs. Okay, so then I have to then choose, I'm a follower of Christ with same-sex attraction. And then here comes the stumbling block for many. Then I must choose a celibate life. Right? Say just like that, right? You talk with them about it. And we talk with them about where our identity lies, right? We also talk with them about their theology, about their God. My son's God, and I'm sure we did this. His God is he has a loving God, and a loving God would not want him to be alone. That's his theology. A loving God wouldn't want him to be alone. So he doesn't have a God that allows suffering in any way, shape, or form. Right? So we also have to be talking about theology when we talk about this. What is true about who our God is? Can we have a loving God that also allows suffering? Because it's true. He does. Scripture tells us we're going to suffer. It doesn't tell us and promise us anything different than that.
Sorry, just a quick question. I read Yaros's homosexuality as a student, and that's where I was first kind of oriented to this sort of these terms.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know if you know this, but something I was wondering while I was reading his book and preparing out the classes, people outside of the church, like the homosexual community, do they like speak in and like understand their own process?
Right. So I would say even within the church, people don't, not just outside the church, because unless you've actually read and been informed by this, you don't. I think the process is true whether you're in the church or out of the church.
Okay, I guess to rephrase, are there non-Christian academics who are writing research about homosexuality?
Not that I've read. And here's the thing, and the field I'm in, I find even Christians speaking out in these terms get slammed. Slammed. Right? So, basically, there is such an intolerance of differing views. Unless you support the views of the LGBT community, you get labeled with a lot of different other words about you. So there's a really intolerance, I think. So I've not read very much writing from non-Christian academics. I haven't read, actually been very little writing around from Christian academics around this, besides your house. I mean, there's not a lot of writing out there that isn't affirming, right? So as a therapist, I have to be really careful when I work with someone. If I work with someone that has same-sex attraction, I have to be really careful because the state of Virginia actually is one of the few states that won't take your license away if you do conversion therapy, which I don't do. I do more of, since I work in a church, we do more talk about, you know, theology and God and that kind of thing. But You have to be really careful this day and age. If you're a therapist and you're working with someone from the LGBT community, because the state laws right now are all about you affirm and nothing more. You affirm and nothing more. As so it's interesting. I was working with a lesbian couple doing couples counseling. And in the midst of my couples counseling with them, we uncovered a ton of abuse for one of them. Ton of abuse. And it wasn't overt. It was covert abuse. So her father had sexualized her, right? Never actually physically abused her, but sexualized her a lot. And she would say things like her dad feels icky and sticky and yucky and just really young, weird words around her relationship with her dad. And in covering a lot of that trauma and that abuse for her, she realized a lot of her orientation was around that. She actually wasn't lesbian at all. But men didn't feel safe to her. So I wasn't there trying to do conversion therapy. We were doing couples counseling. And we ended up then doing trauma counseling that then led for her to uncover what was driving part of her perceived orientation toward women. So it's been interesting. So, you know, to me, I have to be very careful in what I do in that. Now, in the church, I'll be honest with you, very few LGBTs come into the church to have counseling with me. Why? I mean, that would be unprecedented for them to do that. Now, I do work with a lot of men and women with same-sex attraction that are members of the church. But they are members that are struggling because of their faith. They're struggling. So I talk with them about their faith. That's what we talk about a lot. Does that help? Well, a recognition of it starts in middle school, yeah.
Is that something that you talk to kids about to normalize it for them, or do you not want to give that idea?
Yeah. So I think we all need to be very careful that we're always afraid we're going to put ideas in their heads. I think our kids have more ideas than we could possibly imagine. Honestly. You think about, I mean, just think, if you go through the checkout counter at the grocery store, what they're getting exposed to. Right. I used to, when I did children's ministry a lot, I worked with parents, and I had a parent one time say to me, my kid knows nothing about Halloween. And I said, really? Then I think I need to report you for abuse. Because that means you lock them in a closet from the time in August until November. Because they can't go to the drugstore, they can't go to the grocery store. Where can they go that they're not exposed to something about this holiday called Halloween? And they're making up something about it, whether you're talking to them about it or not. So I think it's, you know, I think it's kind of naive for us to think our kids don't have any exposure. It's interesting. I think we have to listen well to our kids. So when I was, my son does not remember this at all, but I distinctly remember the day, and he was probably in sixth or seventh grade, and I'm making dinner, and I'm in my typical harried state, you know, trying to get dinner ready, and blah, 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 and the TV is on, and he says to me, Mom, what do you believe about homosexuality? And something in me said, oh, that feels important, but I ignored it. And I gave him the party line. Well, you know what we believe about homosexuality. What does Scripture say? It's a sin. That's all I said. I shut him down. I clearly shut him down. I don't know where that conversation could have gone, but I know where it didn't go. He said, okay, Mom, thanks. And he left. Came down for dinner and never ever asked me again, what do we believe about homosexuality? Never. So I think part of it is we need to listen well, whether we're parents, whether we work with kids, whether no matter what, we need to listen well. Listen to their questions. Be willing to entertain the question. If I had just stopped and said, why do you ask? I don't know what he would have said, but at least I would have opened the door for a conversation. I slammed it shut, as loudly as it could be slammed. We're not going to talk about this. So I think that's part of, don't, you know, when I work with people who are struggling around sexual addiction stuff, they'll say to me, my kids don't know anything about this. And I'm like, really? I don't think that's true. I don't believe it's true. Kids are the most curious beings that exist. I don't know about you guys. I can remember when I was a kid, when my parents would be away, like even just outside or something, I would go through their stuff. I would. Maybe I'm the only one that did. I went through their stuff. I don't know what I was looking for, but I went through their stuff all the time, right? And kids will find it. They have big ears. They hear stuff you don't think they're listening to. So kids know and they understand way more than we give them credit for knowing or understanding. I think that's true.
You just said homosexuality is a sin, but homosexuality in itself is not a sin.
Correct. Same-sex attraction. Right. So, yeah, let me be clear on that. Same-sex attraction is not a sin. I believe same-sex attraction is part of the fall. Practicing homosexual lifestyle, I believe, is a sin.
I think one thing that happens in the church is when people are preaching will say homosexuality is a sin.
Correct.
When churches want to be inclusive,
right,
it's a good way to chase people away.
It is. It is. So thank you for that. But yes, homosexuality in the terms of having same-sex attraction is not a sin. We do not choose our attraction.
I don't know how much this relates to what we're talking about, but how do you think of a bisexuality and how they feel about attraction?
So, yeah, bisexual to me, I think what I believe happens in some bisexuality is because everything gets sexualized, my feeling of love and closeness and care, I can't feel that without it being sexual. So with bisexuals, I don't know if they have homosexual lesbian tendency or if they have heterosexual tendency. I don't know. But I think what happens is any feeling of love and care and nurture gets sexualized. And so the only way I know to relate to either sex is sexually. So this is from Keller. So Keller at thegospelcoalition.org, this is on this website, and it's a conversation that Tim Keller and Russ Moore and Kevin DeYoung had. And it was around homosexuality. But what I loved is this, what Keller states here. And he says, you know, we automatically start talking about the issue, transgender, homosexuality, we talk around that issue. And when we're talking to unbelievers, as soon as we enter into that conversation, right, we already are in an adversarial place. He said, but if we could back up and talk to folks about what does freedom mean, right? I have the right to do anything I want to do when I want to do it, as long as it doesn't harm anyone else, right? You often hear that. And Keller said, okay, then who decides when it harms someone else? Who decides that? What is harm to you may not be harm to them, and vice versa. I recently experienced this, not in a sexual way, but in the church working with someone. I invited a speaker they didn't like. They had a disagreement. I went, and they said, I harmed them by inviting the speaker. And I went, really? Wow. I wouldn't term that as harm at all. But for them, it harmed them that I didn't care as enough about them to not invite that person, right? So who defines harm, right? And then what forms identity? So these are the conversations we can have. What does it mean to have freedom? And basically, Keller will say, freedom, the best kind of freedom we can have is freedom that has bounds. Freedom that has limits. Freedom that is very clear in its limits to its freedom. And so I just sort of really liked his approach on this. Now, let's hit on transgender for a little bit. So We always hear, or we often hear, about the medical conditions that can cause transgender. And they are real and they are true. There are some medical conditions that can cause someone to be transgender. And honestly, we don't know who has, you and I don't know who has them and who doesn't. So it's really wrong of me to judge every person out there who's transgender and say none of it has any medical basis. Because I don't know. For some it might. So there's some chromosomal abnormalities, right? You can have two X's and a Y, two Y's and an X. You can have chromosome abnormalities, right? They often, these chromosome abnormalities have other symptoms as well to them. Hermaphroditism is basically anatomically you're intersexed, which means you're ambiguous when you're born. Right, you may have internal female organs and external male genitalia, or vice versa. There is, and doctors, so it's been interesting what happens with this is doctors in the past had to decide male or female. Let's flip a coin, right? And then for a while they said, okay, that's really harmful because we found out we've been wrong on several instances, right? And so let's not do anything. Let's leave them intersexed until it becomes apparent if they're male or female. Well, now they're deciding that's really harmful because you have these kids and people will say, is it a boy or a girl? For 3 years? Yeah. Yes. Right? That's very harmful. They found to children is when they don't have, are you boy or girl label early on, what are you? You're it. Right? That's not healthy and good. And so there, but there is a condition that is part, and it's part of the fall, right? Just like everything else, once again, tainted by the fall. Everything tainted by the fall. And then there's some hormonal abnormalities people can have. But the thing is, there's a lot of dispute on how the statistical incidences of this are. But the ranges I found were 0.05 to 1.7% of the population, which is way smaller, I think, than the number of people who are identifying as transgender. So this is not the full story. But it can be someone's story. And that's what I want us to make sure we are aware of. It may not be the full story, but for some, this can be their story. And I want to be cautious, if it's someone who's been born ambiguous, male and female, got made male and actually chromosomally is female, because if you, our sex, our biological sex is more than just our external genitalia, right? When I do the human sexuality class, I talk about the male fetus, and it's fascinating to me. A male fetus is bathed in the highest concentration of testosterone of its life that impacts all of its structures, its brain, everything. There's a reason why that's true. I'm not sure what it is, but there's a reason why it's true, right? So our biological sex is more than just our external genitalia. It's hormonally, it's chromosomally, it's more than how others perceive us. Right. So there's a huge complexity to this. Now, Facebook will tell you there are 58 different gender types. 58. This is only half. Here's the other half. Right. Tell me this isn't confusing to a kid. Now, I am a cis female. It means I identify my gender with my biological sex. Now, why they had to say I'm a cis, I don't know. But I'm a cis female. Now, as you look through this, a lot of these are synonymous terms. They mean the same thing. They're just using different words. Right? But this is how confused our society is. 58. I love non-binary. I'm a non-binary gender. I mean, it's like, or two-spirited. I'm a two-spirited gender. Right. So I mean, there's just some of these that I kind of go, okay. Gender fluid, though, has kind of become what our society, which is what this represents. Gender fluid. My gender is entirely fluid and changing or whatever I want it and choose it to be. It's kind of what society is trying to move toward. Anything is okay. There's no, you know, there's no right or wrong. There's no absolutes. It's all relative. My gender is entirely relative. Which I don't know about you, but that just feels really confusing to me. I can't imagine being a child and how confusing that would be. What do you want to be today? Right, your gender is fluid. You can be whatever you want it to be. Does not feel at all in line with God creating male and female in his image. Gender identity. Gender identity is actually formed, I view it as a triangle. Right? I have my biological sex. That for most of us, that is not arguable. I have no reason to believe my biological sex as female can be an argument. I've had children. I obviously have the body parts I need. I've got the hormones I need. I have no reason to believe biologically I'm anything other than female. And I've never actually had that tested, but I have no reason to believe that's not true, right? But how I perceive myself, now that's pretty fluid. And how others perceive me can be pretty fluid. If I suddenly cut my hair, started dressing like a man, started acting like a man, and started identifying myself as a man, how you perceived me would be different. How I perceived myself would be different. So I do believe there's a lot of fluidness in these two. And I believe they can change. I do believe that's true. Which also is why I believe in Yarhouse's book, it's interesting, he always talks about identity in Christ for homosexuality. He doesn't talk about identity in transgender, which is fascinating to me. One of these days I'm going to ask him why that's true. Why doesn't he talk about identity in Christ with transgender? But I think it's because it's that internal, how do I perceive myself place? How do I experience myself? And here's what I will say. Transgender people are in a tremendous amount of pain. Someone who has truly experienced transgender, they are in a tremendous amount of pain and living in a tremendous amount of incongruence. And we need to never minimize that pain. We need to never act like it doesn't exist. I don't know what it feels like to be transgender. I don't know what it feels like to be in the wrong skin. I honestly don't. But I honestly don't believe that it is God's design for me to be transgender. I don't. So do I believe that incongruence can be part of the fall? I do. I do believe that. But it's interesting because in 2011, there was a study, huge number of people, I think it was like 600 and some people in Sweden, that was done over many years of transgender individuals that had had sex changes. And their research showed that the incidence of suicide was higher or as high as for transgender people that had not had the sex change, and it was higher for than the average population. So transgender individuals believe often that if they have the sex change, they will no longer live incongruently and they will be happy. They will be satisfied. They'll be content. And the research doesn't follow through with that. It doesn't seem true. Having the sex change does not seem to eradicate what's going on with them. Now, there's been some concern. There's not a whole lot of other studies other than that 2011 study. So the LGBT community is basically saying, we need to do more studies around that. We don't believe that's true. But so far, what the studies have shown is, so your house will say for a transgender youth, please, please, please try to delay them from getting a sex change. Please try to hold that off and delay that. Right. It's a really great question. It's actually one of our scenarios we're going to talk about. But I honestly don't, I would not encourage them to go back and have their sex changed back. I don't think they can, first of all, because a lot of times they've removed body parts or used body parts to make new body parts. So you can't go back. I would be talking about them identity in Christ. Where's my identity? What is true? Does God love me? He does. Does he love you, a transgender person who's had a sex change? He does. He does. I don't think that changes. I don't see where it says in Scripture, I will love you as long as you don't have a sex change. Right? I don't see that in Scripture. So that would be my thing. Is our job is to give people Jesus. Show them Jesus. So what I say to my son is, I don't convict my son of sin. I don't think that's my job. First of all, I don't think I can do that, right? My job is not to convict anyone of sin. That's the Holy Spirit's job. My job is to speak truth. My son knows what I believe. He knows what his father believes. And he knows we love him. We welcome him. We welcome his partner at Thanksgiving. We welcome his friends who have nowhere to go. And there's a ton of his friends that have nowhere to go, because their families and their churches have turned them away. That is true. So I would say the same thing for someone who's transgender coming into my congregation.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And how you would approach that with somebody who identifies as transgender or something like that, when, like, with either co-ed groups or
right.
specific male-female groups, and because obviously there's different issues that are talked about, and so what do you do? What do you think about that?
Right. So someone who is truly transgender does not put a risk to the other students that are the same sex. Does that make sense? So if I'm a transgender female to male, right, I'm actually not there interested in guys, particularly if I'm hetero. So it gets very confusing. But I can be transgender and heterosexual, right? So if I'm a transgender male to female, I'm attracted to men. I'm not a gay guy, right? There's a weird thing in that. It's kind of weird, right? So I was working with someone recently who, her father was a transgender male to female, and he married a transgender female to male. Tell me, that's not confusing. And he did that once she was grown, and she now has children, and she's been out of relationship with her dad, and she's trying to figure out how to explain her dad to her children. Granddad, who's actually grandma now. Confused. I mean, the complexity of sin is pretty, fallenness is pretty deep in our world, right? It's pretty deep, right? But a person who is truly transgender is not a risk to the other students. Now, I will say this, though, that happens, and this is what's hard with youth that are speaking that they're transgender, is that experience for that female to male. She doesn't have the same life experiences and isn't able to relate as well to the other guys in that group. So her sense of not belonging, or his sense of not belonging, actually gets deepened a bit, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Can I ask a follow-up question? Mm-hmm. So do you think it's more helpful or harmful to try to direct students towards pro-ed groups?
I don't have anything to back. I've seen no research on that to back that. The thing is, I think whatever we do, we have to make sure we don't separate out the group and make it about them, right? To make once more the isolation even deeper, the sense of not belonging even deeper. The thing with the LGBT community, we're going to talk about this in another slide, but the LGBT community, one of their primary messages is, you belong. Come, you belong. We welcome you. You're one of us. Which is a very appealing message when you're a youth trying to figure out who you are. Where do you fit? Where do you belong? And the message the church, I feel like we have to change, is one of no, you don't belong here. Because we are sitting here screaming at the LGBT community because of who they are, when we're the ones that are sending people there by droves, I feel. We're saying, you can't struggle here with this. We can't handle this. Go away or think like us. And that seems to be the message that often we inadvertently give. So it's a complex issue, Ben, so I don't have a magic, this is what everyone should do all the time. You know, one of the biggest fears at McLean is people who are afraid that people are going to pretend they're transgender when they're not. So we're going to have boys pretending to be transgender females just so they can sleep in the girls, you know, whatever. I don't think that's true. Because to identify as transgender is a really painful thing. And the last thing kids want to do is to be different. So I honestly don't think there's a high risk of some kid, just because he wants to sleep in with the other girls and have perhaps, I don't know what, but random sex on a retreat, I don't know. I think, though, the ongoing impact to that boy of being identified as transgender would be pretty huge. And most youth I've worked with, they all want to be, I don't know about you guys, they still all want to be on the in crowd, beautiful crowd. They want to be in the popular crowd, right? They want to be one of the beautiful people, and the beautiful people tend not to be the people who are identifying as transgender. I don't mean that to be derogatory toward the transgender community, but you know what I mean by that. I mean, they're just, so I think sometimes parents get really wrapped up around this, and it's a serious struggle for kids that are really struggling with it. And here's the other thing, I know people have questions, but, so I had a nephew, I still have a nephew, he's 19 or 20, but for the longest time when he was a child, he wore girls' tights. He liked the way they felt. And he wore them from the time he was about 3 until he was probably 7. I was worried sick about him. I'm like, oh, that's got to be bad. That's got to be a sign of something, right? And that's just, what little boys wear tights for, you know, 4 years? He's the most heterosexual little boy man you ever wanted to meet, right? So I don't know what that was about. And I'm glad I wasn't his mother, because I'm sure I would have made it worse. She just kind of said, oh, whatever, you know, he'll outgrow it. And he did, right? So I just think we need to be careful in that place, if that makes sense.
I have a question, I have a comment.
Okay.
Just didn't want to do anything with God because she felt like God was rejecting his mother, you know, because it was clear in the Bible. So just how
collateral there,
Just going back to the fluidity of gender, I feel like just in what I've been reading about gender relations and that kind of thing in Christian literature, that there can be a swing toward let's make sure everyone gets that the genders are different and create some boxes that men
are. Oh, yeah. Bigger. Stereotypes?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I want to not misrepresent people who really hold
Right. Right. Yeah, that's really good. I mean, our culture, particularly back in the 50s, it was very clearly defined male-female. What men were, what females were, particularly, was clearly defined, much more so than now. I think that's true, but I think there is still some of that now. I do think biblically there is a difference in male and female, right? And do we fully understand and know what that is? I don't think we do, right? But I do know my husband cannot bear children. So to say there is no difference in male and female is not true, right? I also know when I was taking biology back in school, I did, the stuff they let us do was kind of fascinating, but we did some experiments on chicks and roosters. And so we injected roosters with estrogen,
oh, wow.
And we ingested chicks with testosterone. And our chicks started crowing,
oh.
Right, and strutting around like roosters. And our roosters started, like, nesting to lay eggs. There are distinct male and female differences that go to our chromosomal, our hormonal, and our genital differences. That is absolutely true, and that is God's design. So I think we need to look at Scripture and say, what do we believe Scripture tells us is true about those differences? I think there's not a lot in Scripture pre-fall. There is some, but not a lot. But be fruitful and multiply was given to both, right? Dominion and rule. I mean, you think about what was given to both, but Eve did not name the animals. Only Adam did. That's interesting to me. I find that fascinating, right? So there are very unique differences, I think, Scripture tells us that are true. And I think we need to be careful that we don't then have stereotypes that all men are and all women are, right? I think that's true.
So I'm sure you're aware that today is the day that marks a new law in Massachusetts which allows people to use whatever restroom they want to based upon their gender identity.
Right.
And you're not allowed to, really essentially you're not allowed to question that. So there's concern in my church around two issues. One is how do we minister to the women? Men don't feel afraid of transgendered women coming into their bathrooms, but women do. In the public arena, what is happening to them, and what is happening if it's applied to churches under the current drafting to the extent that it's called for secular use? So if we open it up for town day and allow bathrooms to be used, we have to comply with the law. My question is this: as Christians, we tend to go to lines of defense because we're afraid, and the notion that somebody would wake up one day another day and use the man's bathroom. It's the kind of thing that you go to logically when you read the law. To what degree do transgendered people actually, prior to the biology, anatomical changes, to what degree might that happen to them, that they one Sunday use one bathroom and one another?
I think this
is a predator,
right.
So without
regard right,
to.
Right, so right, right. So for transgenders, I don't think it would happen one day, one next, one day, the next, because it's a gradual process of identification. So for someone who's transgender, they often try on the opposite sex for a while to see what feels comfortable. So they're starting to dress differently. They're starting to have the hair differently. It's a gradual process for a true transgender. Now, predators, I'm trying to say, should I even, like, give my opinion on this, so I'm going to give my opinion. No one's ever said I wouldn't give my opinion on things. I think we've probably been going to the restroom for a long time with transgenders and predators. I think that's true. So I think we need to make sure that our children particularly know how to defend themselves, that they know what's appropriate, what's inappropriate, and what to do if someone approaches them inappropriately in a restroom. They should know that anyhow, whether this law came into effect or not is true. I also think we should be very careful to ever let our children go to the restroom alone. I just think we need to be really careful there. I'm amazed how many gay men I talk to. I probably don't want to know the answer to this question, so why I've never asked. But they act out in restrooms. And I'm like, how do you even know which restroom to go to? I mean, am I going to those restrooms? I mean, I don't understand how that works, right? But I suspect stuff happens in restrooms more than we ever imagine. So we shouldn't be letting our children go to the restrooms alone anyhow. As an adult woman, I don't feel particularly threatened by that law. Because here's the thing, I think I've been going to the restroom with transgenders for a long time. I just think that's true. And I haven't known it. And I don't know who's going to police that law. Like if we North Carolina has a law that says right now, they're trying to strike it from the books, but the transgenders have to use the bathroom of their biological sex. Who's going to enforce that law? I mean, is Gordon-Conwell going to stand at the women's restroom and check people's genitalia when they go in? I mean, who's going to enforce that law? Right? So, I just think that there's a little bit in that we have to, the law I get, the LGBT community is trying to do this sweeping change, and that's what we're trying to, that's what we're responding to. But I think we also need to be sort of realistic in that place for ourselves. What does this really mean to us? Pedophilia is not transgender, and pedophiles have been around for a long time. That's true. All right, well, I'm going to move because we need to get going on these because I've got some stuff I want us to work through before we're done, and we're running out of time. So transgender, Scripture does not directly address transgender. I haven't read in Scripture anything that directly addresses transgender, but secondarily, I do read about the sovereignty of God. Right, he knew us, Psalm 139. He knew us in our mother's womb. He knit us there. Right, we were known there. And if I have a God that doesn't make mistakes, I have to believe I have a God that knows if I'm feeling I'm having this transgender issue that he knows that as well. Right, so my sovereignty of God informs what I believe about transgender. Right? And I think people who struggle with it, we need to love them, we need to care about them, we need to try to help understand them. But I don't believe, personally, they should have a sex change. Because if I have a sex change, I'm telling God he made a mistake. I'm telling God I know more than he knows. I'm being God. That's my opinion. Now, you may think differently on that, and that's okay. Because as I said, I do want this to be a place where we actually can differ. You don't have to agree with me. That's okay. But that is how I make sense of transgender. So I would really want to love and try to nurture someone in that place, but really try to encourage them not to be God. And what does it mean for my identity to be in Christ? What does that look like? And the issues around how I perceive myself and how others perceive me. So I love this from Your House about a response. So a pastor meets an individual that tells the pastor that they are transitioning from male to female. The pastor tells the individual he would like to hear their story. He feels he's entering at chapter 7. He'd love to hear about chapters 1 through 6. That seems like a great response. That just seems like a terrific response. Can you tell me about chapters 1 through 6 of your life? I don't want to start at chapter 7. I think we, when we think of a transgender person entering into our church, we want to start at chapter 7. We don't say, can I just sit down with you and have you tell me about chapters 1 through 6? Help me understand those chapters of your life. So sexual addiction. And I am going to end with the church sort of response. But sexual addiction, 57% of pastors say addiction to pornography is the most sexually damaging issue in their congregation. I'm surprised it's not higher. That's a Barnabas 2015 statistic. I'm at Barnabas study. Barna study. So I'm just surprised. Barna group. Yeah. I'm surprised it's not higher. Now, I can look at porn and not be addicted. That is true. Just like I can drink alcohol and not be an alcoholic. Addiction is about compulsive behavior. But it doesn't mean pornography's okay. I don't buy into pornography's okay if two people have never had sex and one needs to learn more how to have sex before they get married. I don't buy into that. I don't believe all of creation's story, people have been able to be sexual without porn. They never needed porn to show them how to do it before. Right? I don't think Adam and Eve had porn to know how to do it, and they seem to be able to be sexual okay. Right? And so I think sometimes there's this buy-in that we need to know more, and sometimes porn is okay. I don't agree with it. Sexual addiction, there's a compulsion to sexual addiction, right? There is, I've tried to stop and I can't. I've said I'm not going to do this anymore and I keep doing it. That's compulsive behavior. It's escalating, right? So for something to be an addiction, it has an escalation factor. It can be escalating in either the type of behavior I'm doing or the frequency I'm doing it. Maybe I started with porn and now I'm meeting prostitutes. Maybe. That's escalation. Or maybe I started with porn and I was only looking at it once a day. Now I'm looking at it 7-8 times a day. And I'm having an impact of negative consequences because I'm doing it at work. I'm doing it at work. I am not focused on my work. So it has compulsion, escalating, and negative impact in somewhere in my life. Spiritually, relationally, school, work, somewhere there's been a negative impact. Now, when we talk about sexual addiction, there's lots of different behaviors we can be talking about. We can talk about paying for sex, right? Prostitutes. Our type of sexual addiction is tied to our story. Someone who is interested in having sex with prostitutes is someone who's trying to control what's happening. They are dictating what's happening, and there is no relational component for it. It's a contractual exchange. I'm giving you money. It's not about getting to know you. I can trade for sex. I can be an exhibitionist. I get aroused by exposing myself. Anonymous sex, that's I don't want to know your name, right? There's tons of chat rooms for anonymous sex out there, tons of them. I can't even read that one. Fantasy sex, seductive sex role. So seductive sex role is it's interesting, people who have seductive sex roles in their sexual addiction is they actually aren't particularly interested in being sexual. They just want to know, can I hook you? Can I lure you? Can I want you to want me? Now, they often will go through and be sexual because they feel obligated. But it's all about, these are individuals I often work with that have 15, 16, 17, 18 different people that they're hooking at the same time. Right? But they don't particularly want to have sex with any of them. Voyeuristic, I want to look at other people. Pain exchange. Intrusive sex are the people, you see them a lot in subways and you see them a lot at airports. Intrusive sex is, I'm going to be sexual to you and brush up against you and you're not going to know it. Right? Subways are huge for it. Huge. Exploitive sex is often an exchange of power, such as a boss and a secretary. Or somehow there's a power differential. There's a cycle in sexual addiction. The upper cycle here is the one actually that we work through to cause, it's actually what I call the cause issue. So it's the underlying cause of what's happening. So I have a belief system about everything in my life. About who I am, who God is, what it means to be a wife, parent, the whole nine yards. But if I have my belief system is a little bit out of whack, I can have impaired thinking. And my impaired thinking can lead into an addiction if I'm not careful. And addiction will always lead to unmanageability. I don't care what kind of addiction it is. Let me give an example. Let's say I have a belief system that says be anxious for nothing. That's what Scripture says, right? Be anxious for nothing. But I've tried every tool I know to get rid of my anxiety. I'm really anxious about what's going on, and I don't know what to do about it. And somewhere along the way, I learned if I looked at porn and masturbated, at least temporarily, my anxiety was reduced. Why is it reduced? Because dopamine and endorphins are getting released in my brain. Those are delightful neurotransmitters. Dopamine is a pleasure neurotransmitter, and endorphins are painkillers, which is why sex is fun and pleasurable. But if I do that over and over again, the only way I know to do anything with my anxiety is to look at porn and masturbate. What happens when I get anxious then, I then become preoccupied. I am preoccupied to go act out because this anxiety is killing me. Then there's a ritualization that can happen to that. A ritualization is kind of what I do to get myself prepared. It's kind of getting, we call it getting in the zone. So maybe I act out after my wife goes to bed. So I am so irritable and angry until they get to bed, she and the kids go to bed. I just want them to go to bed. Will they just go to bed? Please, go to bed. Go to bed now. I don't want to talk to you about anything. I want you to go to bed because I'm preoccupied. And then I'm going to go get my beer, and I'm going to go down. And I'm not going to go look at porn because I shouldn't do that. I know I shouldn't do that, but I'm going to go pay the bills. So I get on the computer, and I open up the banking website. And before I know it, I go from there. Then I go over, and I look at the sports page. And then I go and I dink, 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 dink until I finally get to the porn. That's ritualization. Ritualization leads to compulsive behavior, which for most people leads to despair. Most believers, it leads to despair. For non-believers, it often doesn't lead to despair. If you don't believe anything's wrong with what you're doing, then you don't have despair over it. You just have a honeymoon. You feel better, and we'll just until the next time. And that cycle of shame and guilt just goes on and on and on. The number of people that are struggling with sexual addiction in our churches is huge, and it's hidden. Because addiction is layered in shame and isolation. Shame and isolation. And so we need to be aware of it. We need to be able to talk about it. We need to be able to ask questions. I was talking with a guy that does our, he's in our home, one of our home fellowship groups. Young guy, young family, and he said, you know, I know all of us guys looking at porn. I know we do. We just don't talk about it. Can you help me figure out a way to sit down and talk to the guys? That's a glorious question. Because those guys are now going to experience something different with shame being lessened, isolation being lessened. And they're striving to how can we beat this? How can we do this differently? What does that look like to do that differently? And I don't think they're addicts. I think they're just guys. I don't see any sign of addiction in that. But I think they're guys that know they shouldn't be looking at porn. So, I don't have very much time, and I had a lot of scenarios I wanted us to look at. If we go 10 minutes late, would anyone, like, complain?
No.
Okay. If you need to leave, you can. Okay, so I apologize. So, Mike is a 32-year-old man. He grew up in church. He's a deacon and Sunday school teacher, and he recently began to tell people that he was gay, and last week he came with another man to the worship service. How do you respond? What are you going to do? That's not rhetorical. I want you. Yeah, somebody. Somebody else was? Ben?
I'm just curious about the wording. If you said he was gay, so, like, do you mean that is he is professing?
What do you think? What do you think I mean?
Well, I think that's a question you have to ask him.
Right.
Because is he coming out and saying that he used to be gay and used to struggle with that? Or is he saying, like, is he openly telling people, I'm living a gay lifestyle?
Right.
Right. Because those are two very different things.
Mm-hmm. Good.
So I think Grace is right in that you have to have a conversation with mm-hmm. him.
Right, I was going to say you need to figure out who that other man is. It could be his brother. Right. Yeah. We need to make sure we're not making assumptions. Right? So we need to first of all make sure we're not making assumptions. You know, I'd be curious why he's telling people in the church. If I'm the pastor, I'm going to want to go and say, "Hey, can we have a conversation about this?" Because you're talking to other people, but you're not talking to me. Can we have a conversation about this? Right?
It's an interesting scenario because if you're heterosexual, as a male, bring a woman to the church and having sex with her out of marriage, mm-hmm. is the church going to treat me differently?
Right. Yeah, do we hold the same standard in leadership? Do we hold the same standard in leadership or not? It's a very good question. Because sexual sin is sexual sin. Our Christian culture sometimes makes homosexuality worse. Sexual sin is sexual sin. If someone is living with their girlfriend or boyfriend and they are being sexual, that is sexual sin. It's not any different. Willfully and intentionally living in sin. Not any different. Yeah. All right, so we want more information. We want to make sure we're understanding more fully. I would really hope the pastors and the elders or leaders in the church would get involved here to just try to understand and love him well. But, you know, why is he telling people now what's going on? What do you mean by was? What do you believe about this? For you as a believer? That's the question that needs to be asked. And if he says, if I believe that I can be in an active gay lifestyle and relationship, then our church would not allow him to be in leadership. Right? Every church has to sort of figure that out for themselves. Yeah. Oh, sorry. That's huge. I think that's absolutely huge. I think you're absolutely right. We do have to be very clear and we have to be consistent. Yeah, I would hope we'd be biblical, right? In that clarity and consistency in that place. Someone had one more. Yeah. So, tell me what you mean by that. Tell me what.
So, all the people that are talking about that.
Right.
Oh my gosh.
Right. I think there needs to be some, and probably leadership place, all the leaders in the church sort of surrounding in this place of how do we respond and how do we love him well in that place. To me, I first want to find out why he's being so public. I want to find out why the reason for that and what is he hoping that will achieve in that place. Because he needs to know people are going to be uncomfortable. There are going to be some that are going to be uncomfortable because of this. Right? So I'm going to want to know the fuller understanding for him, but then I then want to talk with people about how... So I think we need to be really cautious in our churches that we don't allow rumor mills to constantly flourish. Right? So if people are coming to me about something that's private and personal, I will say to them, you know, I just can't discuss that with you. Just know that church leadership is handling that. We're working on that. But I can't discuss that with you. Trying to keep people to love each other well and not create rumor mills in the midst of that. Now, in this congregation, we may need to have some discussion around what do we believe. We may have to come up with how are we going to respond, not just to this case, but in general, how do we respond? What do we believe? How do we want to love people well here? We're going to need to move, but go ahead. Yeah.
We did have an incident. Hmm. Nothing was said to the congregation, so the rumor mills began, and who got blamed? His wife. So we do need to say something
right. When
someone's in leadership and they suddenly disappear.
Right.
One has to be very, very careful, but something needs to be said.
At some point, that would be true in that case. I can see in that case that would be true.
If, by the way, he became the prodigal, and he came back.
Right. But I do think we need to be, there are sometimes where church, there is a truth for that place as well, but I think we also need to be careful about privacy and confidentiality and not causing harm in that place as well. Right. So as long as, but our churches do need to know we do have standards, we do have, our leaders are at a certain, and we need to move on to another scenario. Is that okay? Okay, so. Ian's been going to church all of his life. He's married with 3 children and been living a double life for as long as he can remember. Last week, he's finally discovered his stash of porn on his computer and the 15 chat rooms he'd been in communicating and setting up hookups on different dates with all 15. His wife is devastated. They have come to you for help, and what do you do? What do you do? How do you respond? She's devastated.
One thing that initially came to mind would be thanking them and encouraging them about the fact that they came together, that I really hold that in high esteem, you know, that they, I think it shows a desire to work this out for them, to validate them.
Yeah, so yes, I would really want to be having a conversation with him and her, but with him. What is he repentant? Or is he just sorry he got caught? That's a huge difference. A lot of guys are just really sorry they got caught, and they'll do anything to get their wife off their back, and they'll promise anything, and they'll say anything, but is he really sorry? Does he really feel like he sinned against God in this place? Is he really sorry? Is he really, really repentant in this place or not? Yeah, so I would want to be referring him out for someone who deals with sexual addiction, because there are some testing they can do, right? There's an assessments they can do that will decide whether he is an addict or not. I can't imagine he's not, right? But I would want that. I would want him actually getting understanding and help around the addiction. I suspect there's way more than what she has found. My experience is it's only the tip of the iceberg the wife discovers, and he only confesses to what he has to confess to make her feel like she knows it all. And I don't, for a wife, it's called death by 1,000 stab wounds. I found this. Do I know everything? Yep, you know everything. Oh, I forgot about that one. Okay, yep, okay, now you know everything. Oh, yeah, there's that too. Oh, forgot that too. Right? Death by 1,000 stab wounds. So I want that to stop. I want him to get in treatment. I want him to figure out what's going on. And then I want them to have an actual disclosure when he's ready and able to see all that's been going on and all the harm he's done to this relationship. This wife needs a ton of support. Her shame is deep and rampant because she thinks it's all about her. If she'd been a better wife, if she'd have had more sex with him, anything, he wouldn't have done this. She needs a church community that's not going to shame her. Even if she leaves. She might leave for a while. She might need to. I don't know. I tend not to be a big one on separation. I find separation only causes divorce more likely. But she might need to leave. I don't know. But so they both need a lot of love, a lot of support, and a lot of care. And they need us to understand the depth of what may be happening for them. New attender at your church recently asked to meet with you. You know that she's been a recent attender for a class for folks experiencing marriage separation. Oh, this is the one I was talking about. So she tells you her husband is divorcing her after 15 years of marriage. They have two children, girl 10, boy 8. She's been estranged from her dad for 15 years after her parents' divorce. Since then, her dad is transgendered from male to female. He has now remarried a transgender female to male. She is asking for help and how to explain to her children why her dad is now a woman. How do you respond?
I'll call you up. Right.
Thanks. Speed dial, right? How do you respond? Yeah.
I think before going into answering that question, I would like to hear a little bit more about the story that she's going through.
Okay. Right. Well, and I know we all aren't therapists here, but I would actually want to be talking with her about what does she think her response is going to be. She's not seen her dad as a female. How is she going to handle that? Let's not even talk about the kids yet. What is she feeling about this? Has she thought about it, what it's going to be like to see her dad as a female for the first time in her life? There's going to be a huge response for her in this place. Yeah. Yeah, very possible. And here's what I will say on cases like this. We may not have a transgender walk into our church. We may not. I don't know. We might, but we may not. But I will guarantee you, you have people in our churches that are having family members that are dealing with sexual same-sex attraction. You have family members that are dealing with sexual identity or friends. I mean, we may not have the actual individual in our church, but we have people that are impacted and are trying to figure out what do we do? How do we respond? How do we love well? What does that look like in that place? How do we do this? So the messages the LGBT community sends is you are one of us. You belong here, right? You have value. You have status here. You're important to us. Right? We are you and you are us. You will find intimacy and community here. You are created this way and you must live as you were created to be. Right? So, who doesn't love this? Is this not the most welcoming place you'd want to be? Why wouldn't I? Why wouldn't I? Yeah. So, and for a believer, I would say, okay, but then what does your identity in Christ mean to you? What does that look like? I'm not going to argue with you whether or not you were born with same-sex attraction or not. I'm not going to argue that with you. So judgmental. Right. 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 Yeah, and that's, I mean, everyone is on their own journey and they have their own theology of God and of life and who they are, and that is true. And I think in that place, it's always curious to say to someone, why are you here? Why are you talking with me? Right? Why are you here? Right? So if I'm in the church, I'm going to say, so tell me, you know, I just want to know, why are you sharing with me now? Help me know your story. That idea, let me know chapters 1-6. Let me know what's going on with you. How do we love well? How do I care about you as a person? Not just about what your sexual orientation is. How do I care about you? Well, and there's a place we have to say we struggle too. I hope I never send the message that I don't struggle, because that's a huge lie. I may not struggle with what you struggle with, but I struggle too.
I think one of the difficulties thinking about all this is, I think a really good family friend who has Downs, and I believe the Downs is a result of the fall. Mm-hmm. That is not what God intended from the beginning. And a child born with severe birth defects, it's a result of the fall. It's
right.
Not that, you know, as Jesus addressed, it's not that the parents or the child did anything wrong.
Right.
You know, and so then we're left to struggle with, you knit me together in my mother's womb, but my theology does not believe God created the person
right.
that way.
Right.
But it is a result of the fall.
Right.
And so...
And what do you do with that?
Right, yeah.
What do you do with that right. tension?
Because, you know, I've never been able to tell somebody, well, you've got what you've got because of the fall.
Right.
It's like, oh.
Well, that does not help anyone to tell them that either. Right. Nobody wants to hear that.
Right.
Right.
So I'm curious if I'm a pastor, I'm trying to shepherd my church into being hypothetically saying, well, we need to find ways to love and value and affirm. Mm-hmm.
Right, right. That's good.
And in that, how do I deal with the people who are like, but God says he hates it? Mm. Or the person who says, well, you, how do I deal with some of that?
Right, so God hates a lot of things, right? He also says he hates divorce, right? So there's just a lot in Scripture that's true. God hates sin. That's true. Sins of separation from him. That's true. So I think part of it is trying to love everyone in our congregation, even those that are saying, oh, yuck, that's part of their story. So helping them, you know, there's no them and us. There's just us. What does us look like? How do we live in this place as a congregation with all these differences in our stories and what we believe? And I think your house does a great thing here where he talks about 8 possible changes churches can make. First, he says, is humility. It's that place of we don't know. Nature, nurture, we don't know. Cause, we don't know. Humility, we don't know. We honestly don't know, right? And then compassion. Can I be compassionate to another person's pain? Can I have compassion for their struggle? I hope people have compassion for my struggle and my pain. Right? And then we have to value singleness. If we are telling people that you must be celibate, and then we don't value singleness, what do we do with that? What do we give with that? We have to value singleness. Scripture values singleness. Highly values singleness. Somehow the church has gotten, so the church has swung from overvaluing singleness to now overvaluing family. Right? They're both, it's both and. It's not either or. We have to value singleness in our churches. And then we have to give realistic biblical hope. And what I mean by that is God may not take this from you. That may be true. You may struggle with same-sex attraction or transgender issues for the rest of your life. He might take it from you. He could, but he might not. And because he's God, I don't know what he's going to do. I will know. It's in your best interest, whatever he does do. But then how do we live in biblical hope in that place? If that struggle is not taken away, how do we live in biblical hope? Because I think sometimes what we do is we act like it has to be taken away. Right? God's going to bless this and he's just going to take it away. And sometimes he does, but sometimes he doesn't. I was talking to one man who had been in the gay lifestyle, became a believer, became celibate, and God gave him a wife. But he said to me, God gave me one woman I was attracted to, but I still struggle with same-sex attraction. It doesn't mean he took that away, but I'm choosing not to act on it. I'm choosing not to act on it. And then we also have to acknowledge and share in the cost of obedience. For someone who we're saying you can't be in a married relationship, right? You have to live celibate life. There's a cost to that that I don't have in my life of obedience to Christ. I'm not suffering from that, obedience to Christ. There's a cost, and we have to acknowledge it and realize and share in it if at all possible. Absolutely. That's absolutely. Be family to an LGBT person. Be family. Don't just tolerate. Be family. Be there when someone needs to be driven to get a colonoscopy. Be there when someone just needs someone to come over and have a glass of wine with them. Be family. Be what you would do for any member of your family. And then give latitude in language. Oh, sorry.
I just had a question going off of that, and I think someone mentioned it earlier when you were sharing about even your son. So where's the difference, or, like, because this is very practical in my life with friends, family, teammates, between being a family and supporting them versus encouraging that lifestyle. So, like, three examples that constantly will come up in my life is, you know, celebrate, someone just got engaged, gay couple get engaged. My initial response is, from the biblical way. But so how do you respond lovingly? Do you respond in celebration like I would, say, my brother and his wife when they got married and I was overjoyed and so thanking God, but in this scenario, or do you go to the wedding or you hear, mm-hmm. you know, your gay aunts end up having a kid and they're like, hey, dude, what do you think about, we're going to have a kid. We're going to... And just kind of always being surrounded by this and knowing that, yes, speak truth, love them, be a family. But in my heart, I'm like, I respond to my brother's engagement so differently than my teammate's engagement to her girlfriend. And just kind of knowing, like, in your walk of, like, in your experience, or what is that of, like, loving them, but not encouraging it and celebrating that lifestyle, in a sense.
So I think part of it is this place of, I think people people tend to know what we believe, but making sure people know what we believe, mm-hmm. right? So certainly our son knows what we believe. He knows what we believe to be true. His friends know what we believe, right? They know that we do not condone a gay lifestyle. They know that to be true. So I think those conversations happen before the time happens, if that makes sense. So we've actually talked in our family about, you know, if my son decides to marry, he lives in New York, he can marry, will we go to the wedding? We've had that conversation. And we've come to the decision we will. Because I don't know how being out of relationship with my son helps me show him Jesus. I don't, you know, if I'm out of relationship with him, if I've disowned him and abandoned him, I don't understand how then I am to be an instrument in his life. So that's not on the table for us, to disown him and to abandon him. In that place, he knows we don't think he should marry. He knows that. And this is kind of a weird kind of weird twisted thing. We've talked about we won't pay for the wedding. Now, I don't know what that's about for us. That's a little weird. It's all about the finances. But there's something, a statement in that for us in that place. I don't know what that, I don't know, but there is. I've also had a conversation about what do I believe about same-sex couples raising children. I've had that conversation. He knows what I believe. He disagrees with me, and that's okay. If he does have a child, if he does marry and have a child, I will love that grandchild. It's not the grandchild's fault. Right? So I'm going to love that grandchild. But so I think all of us have to come up, where do we draw this line? Because it is this place of, there's a tension there, right? And there's no denying the tension. It exists. How do I walk as a believer? How do I speak as a believer? How am I seen as a believer and have truth and grace? There's a tension, and there's no denying that tension. So I think everyone has to figure that out. I had a pastor once, an older pastor once, said to me, one day you and your son are going to come to a place where there's going to be you're going to have to draw a line in the sand, and you're going to fall out of relationship. I don't believe that's true. I know who he is, and I know who we are. Now, we're not walking this perfectly. Trust me, there's no doubt about that. And every day it's like, Lord, I don't know how to do this walk. But I don't believe there's going to be one day where we're going to have to fall out of relationship. Because he's a grown man. I don't have the right to tell him what he has to believe. I don't have that right. That's not up to me to tell him what he has to believe. He's a grown man. That's between he and his God, and that's what I've said to them. This is between you and your God, not between you and your mother. You and your God. You guys have to sort this out.
Yeah, what if you are a pastor, and you have practiced abstinence for a long time, mm-hmm. you don't believe in sex before marriage, mm-hmm. and then you find somebody that you're attracted to, you marry this person, and on your honeymoon night, you find out that beautiful girl has the same sex with you.
Same sex what?
The same sex with you. That person is a male, not it's male trapping a female body.
Okay.
And you don't believe in divorce. And you don't want to embarrass this person to the public. Because everybody's going to be asking you, why you left your wife after the marriage? What can you do?
Well, that's a tough one. that is tough. I've never had that asked me. I think I would need to have some pastors around me, some church leaders around me helping me navigate through that well. But it feels to me the marriage was done on false pretenses. It feels to me. That feels true to me. Because I cannot imagine God would want me to honor a marriage that is with someone of the same sex when I thought I was marrying someone of the opposite sex. So, but I would need a lot of pastors helping me navigate through that biblically well, what to do with that. So I'm not sure that's an answer for you, but that's a very that would be a very complex one to navigate through.
So kind of the opposite for people who, like me, sometimes I informally counsel students, but I'm not a trained counselor, mm-hmm. or a lot of the people in this room may be ministers or pastors mm-hmm. without training. Can you give us some suggestions on when to discern, when have we reached the pastoral counsel mm-hmm. limits, and when is it better for the person to also suggest they see a trained counselor?
So I would say it depends on what they're struggling with. If they're struggling with faith, I want a person of faith right. speaking into them.
But some of these scenarios you've given, mm-hmm. I think I would want somebody trained. mm-hmm.
Someone with sexual addiction, I want somebody trained in that place.
Yeah.
Because there's just a lot of layers and depth to complexity to it. I mean, would you not want someone trained with addictions if someone was an alcoholic or a drug addict? Right. So I would. I would want someone with training on that. Someone who's got a lot of trauma, I'm gonna want someone that's trained dealing with the trauma, right? Because the worst thing in the world I can do is be an untrained person re-exposing someone to their trauma, because I'm gonna re-traumatize them, mm-hmm. right? I might still re-traumatize them as a professional, but I hope not. But I might. So those are the areas where I need to sort of get a discernment of: am I past my limit of knowledge here? But someone struggling with spiritual issues, right, that's a little different than someone who's really responding to trauma, if that makes sense.
There seems to be a tension that's kind of unspoken between the LBG and the T within the LGBT community. And I'm wondering how that pans out in therapy circles mm-hmm. when you have a sort of rhetoric that says you need to be accepted the way you are and you need to cherish that and love that, and then you've got the T, which is longing for help to find which side of the fence they fall on and stick the landing.
Yeah, that's true.
And it would seem that if you're prevented from doing any sort of help to define someone's identity, that they've got no help at all.
Hmm. Yeah, you would think there would be more. I've not seen there much of that tension between those communities. What I've seen more of, everyone's free to do whatever they want to do. And however they want to do it. It's more of that kind of an attitude, mm-hmm. rather than you don't have the right to choose an identity, you're just the way you're created. I've not seen very much of that tension within the communities themselves. There may be, I just haven't seen it. Mm-hmm. The message I've seen is just one of we just embrace everything. And no one has the right to put their value system on any of us, is more what I've seen in the community itself.
Latitude and language.
Latitude and language is this idea of allowing people, if they're going to identify themselves, don't you insist that they don't? Mm. Right? Mm. Giving them permission for their language of how they're going to describe themselves.
Yeah.
Right? And the last, give an alternative storyline. How God is at work in their story. Mm. Helping them have a different narrative than perhaps the one that they're saying they have to have. Or they're going to have or have had. Give a different narrative there, making sense of their story. When we're talking to people from the LGBT community, just know whether we're talking with a sincere struggler or a justice advocate, because they're very different. Right? Where does the weight of their foot lie? Because a sincere struggler, they're struggling with identity issues. They're struggling with their identity. For a justice advocate, the best thing we can do is be non-defensive regarding biblical teaching. We don't have to defend the Bible, right? We didn't write it, right? It's God's word, it's not mine. I don't have to defend it, right? So we can be non-defensive about it. It's true. I didn't write it, right? And then listen respectfully. Called sort of convicted civility. This idea of sort of seasoned with compassion. Can I be civil with someone who actually disagrees with me? Right? And I love, this is a pastor of Alexandria Presbyterian Church. And he recently said there's two kinds of people in our churches. There are people who know they're messed up, own it, and confess it. And there are people who basically pretend they don't mess up, they won't own it, and they don't confess it.
Right? I think the world sees us as Christians in this category.
That's right.
And I think we need to be seen in this category. Right? I know I mess up. I own it. I confess and I repent. That's how the world needs to see us. This is North Carolina State's motto. To be and not to seem to be. I don't know why North Carolina came up with that motto, but it's a great state motto. I wish it was Virginia's state motto. I need to be. Not seem to be. 78% of our conversation, our communication is nonverbal. We need to always remember that. Always remember that. People know our hearts. And they read our hearts, not just our words. That is true. So if we truly want to be a church that the LGBT community feels like they can at least come and be a sincere struggler in, first of all, we need to make sure that our hearts are such that when they read our hearts, they're not reading disgust. They're not reading contempt. They're not reading that we have our own agenda. And they're not reading that we're trying to fix them. We don't fix anybody. Right? Only God fixes people. I don't fix anybody. So if I'm trying to fix people, I'm in the wrong job. Right? And so that's who we need to be as a church as we reach out. Who are we called to be? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. The second is love your neighbor as yourself. I believe this needs to dictate who we are and who we are to be. So I thank you. Thank you for your time. I'll hang around for a couple of minutes if there's questions, but we are very late, and I very much apologize.